Thank you for being here. Hope you've had a good day. Looking forward to a good week. Pray, ask that you do continue to pray for Brother Steve in the morning. Ask God to have his hand in that. And do continue to pray for those that are having some tests this week. So Miss Diane, she'll be going as well. Amanda, I believe, is going this week. The ninth. They're going to relook at that site. So you do pray for her. Ask God for good news there if it be his will. Pray for revival this week. Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday will be at Shipps Baptist Church in Gurley. I'm thinking it starts at 7 o'clock. I'm not for sure. So if you have a plan on coming, you better call me before you show up. You might be 30 minutes late. I don't know. But we think that it starts at 7. But you pray. I'm not asking you to come. I know it's a long way down there, but you do pray for us. Is there any other prayer requests we need to mention? Do what? Yeah. All right. He's got some things going on, so do remember Miss Diane's son-in-law.
I got a text from Kathy Durham today. Remember Ashley in the morning. Knows all about it.
Ashley Durham. Remember her. Anyone else?
David, y'all remember my mom.
All right. Remember Miss Kathy when we pray. Anyone else? Continue to remember Lauren. Continue to remember the guy having open heart surgery tomorrow. Do ask the Lord to touch in that. Remember, by the way of announcement, the seniors will meet here at 11:30, going to Rangeville to 50 Taters Saturday, so don't forget about that. Any other announcements? All right, if not, we'll ask our young men to come forward. We'll take up our evening offering.
I'm gonna take a trip to the good old gospel show. We will be again when life is o'er, where we will been a long trying time, but can't afford to turn back now. He's not going to let us turn back. I believe that once you're saved, by the grace of God, then you're saved. Everybody that would stand, let's fellowship for just a moment.
Have your Bible, we'll be in Psalms 119 this afternoon. Psalms 119, verse 89. If you would stand, we'll read God's word and then we'll pray. We'll give you the thoughts that God has laid upon our heart this afternoon in Psalms 119. Let's begin reading in verse number 89. Forever, O Lord, Thy word is settled in heaven. Thy faithfulness is unto all generations. Thou hast established the earth, and it abideth. They continue this day according to thine ordinances, for all are thy servants. Unless thy law had been my delight, I should then have perished in my affliction. I will never forget thy precepts, for with them thou hast quickened me. I am thine, save me, for I have sought thy precepts. The wicked have waited for me to destroy me, but I will consider thy testimonies. I have seen an end of all perfection, but thy commandment is exceeding broad. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the word of God tonight. Thank you for the songs that have been sang. God, we thank you for eternal life. Thank you for your presence. Thank you that you are faithful. And God, we pray, God, you'd put your words in our mouth this afternoon. I pray, God, you'd speak through us, encourage our heart. God, in troublesome times, Lord, we pray, God, that you just bring confidence through your word. God, we ask now you do that according to your will and your purpose in our life. And God, we pray you'd forgive us, help us, cleanse us. Now in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. The psalmist begins with here in this portion of Scripture, and I believe that as I have reread this, and I believe the psalmist was aware that God in His faithfulness, how that God, and through creation, we'll see that in this portion of Scripture as well. But yet, he said there in verse number 89, as he begins to speak to our heart, and he said, now talking about the word of the Lord, He really describes where the word of the Lord is, and he says that it is settled in heaven. Now I believe that it brought confidence to his life, that he understood that God's word didn't change. And I thought about this, that it is in heaven, it's beyond the reach of humanity. And you think of the day that we live in, that they try to change things. A lot of things change in life, but I believe the confidence of God's faithfulness here, how did he thought upon the word of God that it didn't change? We have to understand that we serve a God that is right to start with. We would be in a desperate situation if we woke up tomorrow and God changed his mind about something. But, you know, he said that we can serve a God that doesn't change. And that, I believe, is something that would produce confidence in the psalmist in his life. And you think about the world today, they love to change the Word of God. One commentator that I read after said that the Word of God is not antique. It's not even up to date. The Word of God is eternal. And thank God that we serve a God that is eternal. But he said, O Lord, your Word is settled there in heaven. We have to understand that is the confidence that he had, that this is not the thinking of humanity. This is not even the ingenuity of the brilliance of humanity. This is God breathing. And I like what Paul said, all Scripture is given by the inspiration of God. Not all Scripture writers, but all Scripture. The words that we have today is settled in heaven. And you think about that. And how that it brought confidence in his life. You know, I'm glad as I think about Peter and his life. You know, Peter made a drastic mistake, but God knew that from the beginning, and God didn't turn his back upon Peter, did he? God forgave Peter. I'm glad that God's word is settled in heaven beyond the reach of humanity. It cannot be distorted. It cannot be changed. And I'm glad that it is established. It is settled. And you think about this word settle has the idea of a firm, fixed foundation. And when something is firm and fixed, it's like the Bible talks about a man that built his house upon that rock. And when the storms of life came, it stood the storms of life. But yet there are those that build on sifting sand, do they not? And when the storms come, the Bible said that the house and the great was the loss of it. People are building their life on everything other than the foundation of God's word. You can build a life. I'm not asking you, you know, you think about investing in things of monetary value. I mean, you could lose money, but you don't lose your life over that. You don't lose your soul. I'm talking about the greatest investment that God has given you, your soul invested in eternity and laying up treasures in heaven where moth and rust do not corrupt and thieves don't break through and steal. There is settled in heaven, far beyond the reach of humanity. There the word of God is. I'm glad that there is something fixed in heaven that we can base our life upon. You can hang your soul upon this truth. Amen. That God is settled. God knows. You think about God's word in verse number 90. He says, thy faithfulness is unto all generations. He says, thou hast established the earth and it abideth. God is talking about now his faithfulness. How that he rules over creation. God is faithful in all of his dealings. And the Bible said, even unto all generations. And you think about the word of God. You know, I read a story of a guy one time. I can't tell you exactly his last name. But he vowed within 50 years of his lifetime, the Bible would be in a morgue, is what he said. We're going to stomp out the Bible. And you realize the more that people try to stomp it out, try to do away with it. And even in certain countries, even to this day, it's a capital offense to own a Bible. But we still have a Bible. They can't do away with the Bible. This is the truth. And one guy said, in 50 years, he said, this Bible that we read will be in a morgue. Well, in 50 years, the man had died. And if I understand correctly, the Geneva Bible Institute bought his house and it is used to store Bibles. Amen. You think about that. The more they try to do away with God's word, the more that it prevails. And you think about this. Thank God that it has endured unto every generation. It is still pure. It still brings life. And we'll see that in just a few moments. We still believe the word of God gives eternal life for those that have put their faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And God is faithful, is he not? Just say, for instance, if something were to happen to me, if something were to happen to me, the same God that saved my soul is the same faithful God that will reach down through the generations to my children or to my grandchildren, and it's still the word of God that will save their souls. I'm glad that God is faithful unto all generations. You think about that. Some of us may look back over a period of time in our life. Maybe our grandparents didn't follow God. Maybe our parents didn't follow God. But somehow God in his infinite wisdom reached down and he found where we were. Thank God. If they quit preaching the Bible, God still has a faithful remnant that will rise up and carry his faithful word unto all generations. God's word will endure until the end. The Bible said heaven and earth is going to pass away, but God's word is going to endure throughout eternity. Amen. I believe God's word is fixed. I believe God's word is firm. I believe God's word is faithful, don't you? We serve a faithful God. I mean, God is faithful to his promises. God is faithful to his people. You think about that. And I'm not always talking about how that we feel in our circumstances of life. Hey, you could imagine how Joseph must have felt there in that prison there when the butler and the baker had forgotten all about him for a period of time. But God was still faithful to Joseph in the prison where that he was. God is faithful, is he not? And that we can actually see God in his faithfulness. Let me tell you that God is so firm. God is faithful in the fact that He said, Thou hast established the earth and it abideth. What do you mean? That he commanded the earth. He spoke it into existence. Now you think about this. The astronaut we just saw on the news last week, one came home. He had been out in space for 360 days, I believe. And you think about, he's looking back at the earth and it's hanging on nothing. I mean, it's amazing to me that people deny the existence of our Creator. I mean, you think about this. I mean, it's supposed to have just blowed up, right? Just blowed up out of nothing, and all of our planets are perfectly round. I don't get it. I've never seen a stick of dynamite go off and blow up everything and it turn out round. Have you? Not, there's no way possible, is it? I mean, if you just open your eyes, you can see that God is faithful. And the fact, hey, ever since God spoke it into existence, what He's saying here, that I've created this thing, you can trust in me. I spoke it into existence, and He said it still abideth. He said, and they continue this day according to thy ordinance. He says, for they are thy servants. And I believe I could elaborate on that for a long time, but just to move on hurriedly, to think that God said, I want you to rotate around the sun, you know, on a certain axis, and I want you to do that until I tell you to stop. And it's still doing that today. Let me tell you, according to God's word, let me tell you, I may not be here tomorrow, but the sun is going to rise on time. I'm telling you, the sun is going to rise on time. How do you know the sun's going to rise? They say it's going to burn out. Well, I know Jesus has got to come back. I know that there's a period that we spoke about this morning. It's not going to burn out for at least 7 more years, because the Bible said that it wouldn't, because there's going to be a 7-year period that God's going to judge the earth. So I know that it's going to last at least 7 more years. That's all I can give you. I can't tell you I'll be here, but I can tell you tomorrow that it's still going to preach faithfulness when it rises up. I'm faithful. It's going to, in a 24-hour period, it's going to say, I'm faithful. And you can look at that and say, hey, God is faithful, right? Look at creation. There, I want you to start, this is something that has happened in my life just in the last few months, maybe a few years, but I'm beginning to see God in creation. We had a litter of puppies not long ago. They're born blind. They're born with their ears closed. But they're born also knowing where to find their meal. I mean, you don't have to read a book to them. I mean, you don't have to show them the way. I mean, they're just going to do the way that they're designed. Why? Because God is involved in creation, and God is faithful to His people. God's not going to turn His back upon us. I'm not going to say we're not going to endure hardship, and the psalmist is going to encounter some of the difficulty in his life, but he understood God was faithful. You can trust in a God that doesn't change. You know, laws are always changing. I mean, things are always changing. But God doesn't change. It's fixed. It's settled. And it doesn't matter what I say about it. It doesn't matter what the theologians say about it. What matters is what God says about it. God says, I'm faithful. God says that you can look at creation and hear as He has designed that. God says they abide. And He said they continue this day. And the Bible said, they're my servants. They serve me. You think about that. How does His creation serve Him? You know, I've thought about this long and hard. We are the only created beings that don't serve God. I mean, you know, when Jesus stepped out and He spoke peace to the wind, the disciples said, what? My, even the wind obeys Him. And you think about this, how that creation is serving God. You know, God can do what He wants to do when He gets ready to. God had a rebellious preacher one time. God had a preacher that turned his back, and He bought him a fare on the way down somewhere to Tarshish. And what did God do? God sent the wind. He sent a great storm. The storm obeys Him. And they throwed him overboard, and what happened? Not only did the wind obey him, but the whale obeyed him. There was a great fish that was prepared, the Bible said, that swallowed up Jonah and took him where He wanted Jonah to be. He's saying His creation obeys Him. He says here that they're His servants, and that we can see God's faithfulness in everything. You know, if I drop this, what do you expect to happen? It's going to fall to the ground, right? That's God's law of gravity, and it exists unto this day. Listen, understand, if it changed, it would be chaos. But here, everything is according to plan and purpose. And he says here, and they continue to this day. He says, for they're thy servant. He says here, unless thy law now had been my delight, I should have perished in my affliction. You think about that. He says here that even in the midst of trouble, God's word was special. God's word had produced life. And we'll see in verse 93 that it quickened him. It gave him life. It gave him strength. I was reminded of how precious the Bible is to people of different ages. And really, the Bible should be, but that's what Peter said the Lord was to him. He said he was precious. And really, the Word of God, you know, and we understand as we read through Psalms 119 that this psalmist couldn't put a value upon God's Word. It was worth more than, the Bible said, fine gold. He said, much, much fine gold. It was valuable to him. And there is where he found his strength. He found confidence in God's faithfulness. He understood that God met him in his Word. And he said, I would have perished in my affliction, God, if I did not see how that you were faithful to your people. How that God will do what he said he will do, when he said he would do it. God is faithful, so we understand. He said, unless, you know, your law had been my delight, there was joy in the Word of God. I was reminded as I was reading through, preparing for this message, one commentator spoke of an elderly woman somewhere, I believe in Scotland. And if I'm not mistaken, maybe Spurgeon was quoting some guy by the name of Alexander. And he talked about how there was rations given to the poor. And there was a poor widow had maybe a piece of copper, maybe just a couple of pieces. And that was all that she had. And she goes into the grocery store. I mean, a poor widow. I mean, she's a pauper. She has nothing. I mean, he said, as I'm reading this, the commentator said that the manufacturing was closed in the town. It was something, I mean, a place of desperation and hit the whole town. It affected everybody. But this woman, instead of going into the grocery store buying food, it said that she walked in there and she said, I must have oil that I can read my Bible. That was her strength. And the Bible says that the Word of God is more valuable than even food to our body. Why? How can it be? Because it speaks of the things of eternity, does it not? As we spoke about heaven and God's throne room this morning, aren't you glad that the Bible is a reality? I'm glad that it is something to me. This is not a fairy tale. This is not something that we just gather together and we go through the motions and try to help everybody feel better about what's going on around us. This is a place that we gather, that we're fixed on a foundation of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that we know flat-footed that there is a better day coming, and it's going to come soon. Thank God that he's prepared. We understand that, and the Bible said even, we know that the worlds were hanged by the Word of God. But now he said, I will never forget thy precepts, for with them thou hast quickened me. And you think about that. Prior to the day of salvation, we were dead to our sin. We were dead in sin. We were at a place, as Paul said, we were without hope. Amen. We were strangers from the commonwealth of it. I mean, we had no part, we had no inheritance. But God, in his mercy and infinite grace, reached down and give us life. God's word brings life. The Bible said by faith, you know, they understood. By faith. And faith, we understand that it produces a confidence in God. And it is God's word that really, if you're saying, you know, my faith is weak. My confidence in God is weak. Well, that is the time of opportunity that we spend more time in God's Word, because this is where we find strength when God speaks to us through his Word. Amen. You know, oftentimes we want to just sit down and open up our Bible, maybe to fall to something, you know. But no, you know, I found out sometimes God doesn't speak to me immediately. Sometimes I have to spend time, and sometimes I have to read the whole New Testament. Sometimes I have to read a whole book. I mean, but you know, I'm thinking, you know, and I understand God. Maybe I don't understand him completely, but he knows if he spoke to me immediately, I'd neglect Bible reading. You know, sometimes I have to dig this out. I have to search it out. And the proverb said, Solomon said, if you'll seek wisdom, if you'll seek the word of God as if it were fine gold. I mean, do we understand the value of the Bible? I mean, if somebody told me there was oil in my yard, man, I'm going to call the best well digger I can find and we're going to sink a bit before morning. Amen. We're going to look for black gold. Amen. Texas tea. And we're moving to Beverly Hills with Jed Clampett. Amen. We're going to find out. But you know what? That what's more valuable than that black gold, that Texas tea, is the word of God. Amen. I can die flat broke and you, church, will have to bury me. But understand, eternity is waiting upon me, and I'm going to see the throne room of God. Amen. One day the faith will end in sight, and you're going to say God was right, God was faithful. Hey, it's not to be compared, Paul said, with the glory that is to come. I'm saying there's joy in the Word of God. I'm glad that there's strength. I'm glad that there's life. It's everlasting. God's Word doesn't have to change. The problem is men have to change to meet the... What am I trying to say? Men have to change their heart to line up with the Bible. He says here, for I'm thine, O Lord. Now this is important. He says, save me, for I have sought thy precepts. The wicked have waited for me to destroy me, but I will consider thy testimonies. What the psalmist understood, that God was in control. That he could be dependent upon God that had saved him through his word. Now realize this, that he is leaning upon God. He said, I am thine. That shows the responsibility of God in our life. God is going to care for us. God is going to meet our needs. God is going to meet us where we are. He said, I am thine, save me, for I have sought thy precepts. In seeking God, he understood that he belonged to God. Now that's, there are a lot of organizations that it would be good to belong to. But there are certain organizations that we cannot belong to. But yet, the greatest that we can belong to is God our Creator, is it not? It is there that he finds, hey, God, I'm yours. I'm thine, you're mine. Hey, I'm yours. God's responsibility to care for us and to think about this, that God has delivered all of his children safely in that passage of the portal of the home that is in heaven. He said, though that they wait upon me. Now, according to the word of God, we must understand that we will face difficulty in life. There are just times that we're going to face, but God will face them with us. Now, you may not feel that you're in revival. You may not feel that God's presence is near. But as we say many times, if we look back over our life today, we can assure ourselves that God has been faithful even in the midst of difficulty. God was there. God was evident. God was with us. His word promises us that he'll never leave us. He didn't turn his back upon us, even in our faults and failures. Aren't you glad that God still forgives? Aren't you glad that he doesn't cast us off? As I said at the beginning of our message, boy, it'd be a bad day if we wake up in the morning and God changed his mind about us. Boy, I'm telling you, how bad that it would be to face an eternal hell. How bad it would be to live life without the presence and the power of God. But he doesn't change his mind. Once he accepts you, you belong to him and he belongs to you. He has ownership over your life. You're bought with a price, the Bible said. Not with silver or gold, but the Bible said, but by the precious blood of Christ. I belong to Christ. We are a royal priesthood, Peter said. We're a part of something greater than that we can even see with our own imagination or our eye. The Bible said, Paul said, he can do exceedingly above, far more than we can ask, even think, even imagine in our mind. What you can dream up, God said, Paul said, God can do more than that. I'm a part, even through the wickedness, even through the trials of life. The Bible does give us hope, does it not? Boy, could you imagine a world without a Bible? Could you imagine a world without God? I'm glad I'm not going to stick around to see it. And let me say and finish with this conclusion. He said, I have seen an end of all perfection. He said, I've seen an end to a lot of things. I've seen life come to completion. But he said, thy commandments, they're exceeding broad. Now we're gonna make a passage through this narrow way that we call death. But with God, I mean, once we go through that passage of death, he said, it is exceeding broad. You know, the world would try to claim that there's no joy in serving God. There's no use. There's just no end. There's no reward that we spoke about this morning. It's fruitless, but the Bible said in His commandments they're exceeding broad. The psalmist could view his life and understand that he was placed in a place where there was freedom. I mean, he understood what life was all about. He understood that God had given him breath. He understood that God had commanded creation into existence. He understood by the faithfulness of God and walking here as he viewed those things around him, he understood that the best life was that of serving a faithful God. Let me tell you today, it's still the best life on planet Earth, serving a faithful God. No matter what the devil said, no matter what the devil's crowd says, God says in His Word that His commandments are broad, and I'm thankful to God that there's freedom found in the Word of God. You know, people are bound today, and they don't even know they're bound. I mean, they're prisoners to the world system. They're prisoners to Satan. But thank God that He reached down through His Word and He set me free. I'm glad that the hand of God reached down and took the handcuffs of sin and set me free and allows me to walk in freedom, allows me to walk in His favor. Thank God I'm glad that I can walk with God and He walks with me. And I'm glad that we can have a relationship in His Word. I'm glad God speaks to us. I'm glad that God is active in our life. I'm glad God does not neglect His children. I'm glad that though times in our life we face frustration, we even face failure, but thank God we have a God that doesn't change. A God that is faithful. And I close thinking about how God has been faithful in all of our lives. God has never turned His back on us. Even though at times in my life I have probably deserve God to turn His back and walk away, but He never has. And God's Word doesn't change to fit new modern thinking, humanism. Amen. God's Word is fixed. God's Word is firm. And God is faithful. You know, and I believe that with all of my heart, and it brings me joy. If God doesn't return to the earth soon, and I leave this walks of life, and my children and my grandchildren and my children's children's children, I'm glad that there's still a faithful God that will be there to redeem them and offer them the presence of eternal life in their life as well. I'm glad God's faithful today. I'm glad that I look around Him and everywhere that I see and all that I see, I can see God is everywhere. I'm glad that God today proves His faithfulness. You think God's not faithful? You can look at nature itself and it will prove unto you that God is faithful. We have the laws of gravity, do we not? I mean, we have laws that God has instituted, light. He said, let it be, and it's been ever since. Understand what God is doing in our life and why that He is doing that is because He is faithful. Let me tell you, you can serve a God that doesn't change. You think of all this, and Brother Robert, come get us a verse of invitation. I thought about this as I was looking over this passage of Scripture. We serve a faithful God in love and kindness. And we of all the world's religion, you can really boil it down to this. All other religions in the world is man trying to reach up to God. But we are the only ones that serve a God that reaches down to man. Thank God, that's what sets us apart from all of the religions of the world, is our God knew we were unable to reach Him. And He reached down in faithfulness through Christ. And He picked us up. He redeemed us. He saved us. And we can serve Him with confidence that He doesn't change. Would you stand with us? 237. 237.